have been working in safe environment, which probably want to contribute in the answer. So we have one, two, okay, you also want to take, okay, three, four, and let's see topic by topic, how it goes. So what I see here is, it's kind of a flow. It may start from, like, how do I get started on my safe journey? Maybe this is like the first thing. Now we have to decide to do it at the last, or we want to do it at first. Because both widget fits. Either we close widget or we start widget. So something like that. And so this is something like a basic question. I would like to understand more about safe and agile. Yeah. So something like this. So anyone want to talk about safe in say 5 minutes, maximum 5 minutes. Anyone want to take an opportunity to talk about safe in less than 5 minutes? It could be 2 minutes also. Okay.
So this question is from whom?
Yeah.
Meetup. Okay. So.
But you need to address all, like, it's for everyone.
We usually talk about agile, but agile also have some base principles which are taken from lean management. And then when we talk about agile, we usually talk about teams. Is 3 to 9 people, but we do not talk about agile at an enterprise level. That means we're working with 100 people, 1,000 people. How you make sure that all the teams are working in a synchronous and coherent manner. So then it's not about team management, project management, it comes to program management, portfolio management. So at an enterprise level, when you're talking about program management, then we go into a different realm, which is called scaling agile. Now, scaling agile have different methods. The oldest one is DAG, and the newest one is Scrum at Scale, and the most popular one is SAFe. And SAFe basically takes good practices from all other principles, like various other principles which comes under agile, like XP, Kanban, Lean, and they actually define the processes clearly at the team level, program level, portfolio level. And it's a very heavy framework. There is a huge learning path. And yeah, I think that's it.
Good, thank you. So you can give a brief introduction now, and next time onwards, before you speak, you need to introduce yourself in 30, less than 30
minutes. I have spent a lot of time, I have like little more than 18 years of experience. Out of that, probably 10 to 12 in waterfall, 6 years in agile. And now I'm actually kind of aspiring as an agile coach. And when you try to be an agile coach, you look into a lot of other aspects like facilitation coaching and also scaled agile frameworks. Because different organizations experimenting with different kind of scaling.
Great.
So SAFe is very useful. Everybody use some kind of SAFe.
Good, thank you. Now anybody would like to add incrementally? Yes, I see. Incrementally, an additional thing. Oh, what do you understand from this answer?
Okay. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, reply back.
So,
your understanding.
Okay. So basically, I am altogether the different background.
Okay.
And I my basic take away what I am expecting from this meetup, like just to understand what is safe, what is agile and all. Because in my organization, it got a lot of focus. Yeah. And you speak any business line, they will talk about agile and safe.
Good.
Yeah, that's why. I mean, I'm basically like a SCM guy, okay, supply chain management guy, who does the contracting, negotiating, those kind of things. And also I thought, because of this, I may get a lot more agile coaches here, and I can engage them to my organization.
Good idea.
This is the basic things. That's what
the agile contracting is a software.
It's a good idea. So what do you get out of SAFe? So what we understand is that SAFe is something which helps you to take the agile to a bigger level. Traditionally, agile has been implemented for small teams. But when you want to build a big system together, and you want to use agile way of building big system together, you look for something which integrates multiple efforts and help you to build a big system. That is what the SAFe is doing. The another thing which Tanmay has pointed out is, it also gives you a mechanism to integrate strategy with execution.
Yes.
So it's like working with more people and also a top vertical alignment where the portfolio strategy can get aligned with execution. So that is good enough to start with, and gradually we will see what all comes in. Yeah. Great. So we got through one. How do we get started? Was it shared services, career growth, and what after the same do we need to? I think we get started with this question now, which is kind of a meetup question as well. How Scrum Master role is different in SAFe? Okay, so we take this particular question. Who wants to talk? Anybody working in a SAFe team as a Scrum Master here? Anybody working as a SAFe team as a Scrum Master? You want to talk?
Yeah.
Introduction first and then talk. Yeah.
So basically, my background is from UI/UX. I'm working as a project manager, come Scrum Master. And a few months back, I've done my I'm a certified Scrum Master. I have done my certification 3-4 months back from Scrum Alliance. I'm just handling the project as a Scrum Master, but I don't know anything about SAFe, being very honest.
Okay, but your organization is using SAFe as of now?
Yes, so we are handling, we are into finance banking domain. We are working for Federal Home Loan Bank of New York. And it's a software development company. We are following Scrum. Release is going on in sprints and all the ceremonies of Scrums, like retrospective planning. Everything is in, but not at the SAFe or something. So want to know how SAFe is useful for Scrum Masters. Mm-hmm. And want to know my career plan also for future. Like if I'm Scrum Master today, what next shall I do? So because it's kind of like, I want to go for the product owner course also, because my role is also related to product owner.
Okay.
I'm you know, talking to stakeholders on day-to-day basis, getting the requirements from them. Like, so it's a mixed kind of role.
Okay, good.
So that's why I'm here.
Thank you. So anybody would like to add here? Introduction and speak.
Hi, I am Aditya Swarup. I am a Scrum Master in FireEye. We are trying to implement SAFe. So I've gone through the training very recently. So I would like to use this board and this picture, and maybe you can talk here.
Yeah, sure.
So mostly what happens is a traditional Scrum Master would work in this area where we have a backlog, team will progress, and we'll deliver implementation. Whereas if you become a SAFe Scrum Master, you have to work on this one as well, where you have a PI goal. So now the tracking is slightly more different because you are tracking towards a PI as well. So during your PI planning, you will be doing a lot more work upfront, whereas in Agile, we were taught that do it just in time. Whereas over here, we have a cadence where we have to do things at least for a quarter. A lot of people have that. SAFe recommends 4 to 6 sprints in a...
8 to 12 weeks.
Yeah. So that's how you have to at least predict how much work you can deliver in that time. And you kind of, not commit, but forecast that what would be done when. So your Scrum Master role is slightly more tricky in that framework. You have to work with the IT. The IT concept was not there in SAFe, where we had something called Scrum of Scrum, but it was more in one-on-one. Basically, everyone was equal in Scrum of Scrum, whereas over here, you have a person who is kind of presiding over that meeting called IT, who is responsible for getting the impediments removed for the whole training. So that is your career ladder. First, you can get to an IT role, then you can go to a system SDE, and then maybe somewhere around the strategy if you are really good at that. So that's a career progression. In the same thing, you have a lot of other things that you can do. You can work on the matrices that we do. So how are we doing on the, then the, one more thing that really helps and is different from Scrum is, in Scrum we have got, at the end we have one retrospective, whereas in SAFe we have got an IP sprint, and in that we have inspect and adapt session. That's where most of the Scrum Master and few of the team members, they contribute back to the organization level discussions, and they handle the impediments which are almost common to everyone. And that's where it's slightly more different. In this sprint, you'll have a discussion at the very end when you do a system demo, and then you talk about what were the impediments the team had, and you kind of represent your team. That's my understanding of
Thank you.
The only thing that I might want to add is that that could be a possible career path, that when you're moving from the Scrum Master to an RDE, and RDE is kind of a Scrum of Scrums in some languages, and RDE also helps facilitate across the trains, because if you're multiple trains, then who becomes your Scrum Master?
What is the full form of
Release Train Engineer.
Okay.
Release Train Engineer. You know, some people wanted to be release train manager because they're pretty senior people, but it's actually release train engineer, and that guy, think of RTE to be the scrum master for the entire train, right? So that one of the career path that you mentioned, from a scrum master to an RTE to a STE moving forward, but then you can have, as you mentioned, that you might have interest in other product organization as well, so you can very well move into the product management or the more all around solution management if you're working at the solution train level, and not just an STE, but you can also do solution train management. And it totally depends on how the implementation is of SAFe. If there are multiple trains and then those trains need to come together, so you get an RTE, or you could take a product management role as well. So it totally depends.
Thank you. Now, since it's a meetup topic, I think let's spend a little more time there, okay? And because this was something declared stuff. So what I see, again, it's an invitation to discussion further. Like, when you work in a nuclear family, you live in a nuclear family, and you live in a joint family. So the little bit process changed. So SAFe is like living in a joint family. You need to manage lots of stakeholders. And in a nuclear family, your team can decide whatever they want to do, your family can decide, they can go for a movie tonight, but in a joint family, you can't just decide that you want to go for a movie tonight. Yeah, you have other stakeholders, other dependencies. Now, if you take this little forward, many times, all this role of a scrum master, project manager, program manager, it's all about managing stakeholders and communication, communicating effectively. See, you do a daily scrum, you do a scrum of scrum, but it's just not going there for 15 minutes. It's also talking about the right thing, finding out the right problem, using the right language so other person get it, so that they act on it. This skill is more and more needed when you are doing SAFe level scrum master role, because you are now talking to peer level and senior level stakeholders more and more frequently. Whereas when you are doing Scrum Master Scrum role, you talk to teams, you facilitate teams. You primarily more like a listener and facilitator. You listen, facilitate. But as a Scrum Master in SAFe environment, you are also a spokesperson of your team when you are going to Scrum of Scrum. Now here you need to use a language which creates sense of urgency in others. So your team is stuck because of some dependency. Nobody will look at it till the time you make it visible enough. And that work was not that much needed when you do small scrum team, scrum master role. So as a skill, improvement in communication, highlighting dependency, and looking at the overall system thinking. Now this all requires that you can think of, oh, my 12 teams are doing it, and if this doesn't happen, how overall this thing will get impacted, so let me communicate in that way. So knowing what other teams are doing, you need to have an insight about it. So this all skill is needed, and you show this all skill frequently every week in a scrum of scrum meeting. And that's something, an essential part of it. The another role I see is, since a lot of interdependencies, yeah. So doing retrospective to find out real issues are a little more challenging here. So you are not independent, you are always stuck because of someone else. So you need a more better facilitation skill in your retrospectives as well than a normal scrum master. So that is something more. And if you show better skills in a SAFe, you have also an opportunity, since multiple teams are working, there's a high possibility that you get an opportunity to serve multiple teams. So the expansion of your role is easily possible. You may end up handling two teams sooner than a normal scrum master role. And then it can lead to a role for release train engineer, who is like a scrum of scrum, scrum master. So he's a scrum master for multiple teams together, and he requires more stakeholder management, more facilitation skills. So stakeholder management, which is like not that much emphasized skill for scrum master, is an essential skill for SAFe scrum master. Okay.
So scrum master can work with one team, but if you are following like SAFe, you have to handle multiple teams.
Not necessary. Not necessarily. You get an opportunity to do that. But even if you are handling one team, you interact with multiple team scrum masters, because you are somewhat dependent on them. Your team is not a nuclear alone now. You are input to someone, you are output to someone. So you need to have a good communication skills and stakeholder management skills so that you can protect your team as well as you can get things done for your team.
It's different for Scrum Master and SAFe is different from product.
No.
Or is it SAFe?
It's what he's saying. He's saying that it's
same.
But you need additional facilitation screen. Even at a micro, see, we have this macrozone and microzone, right? At a cellular level, it's a Scrum. But then we are looking at organization level.
No, but then, sorry, I'm taking some.
So that's what he's saying. The normal Scrum and product owner is looking into the work allocation only of 9 people. Right? So the scope is very short.
We'll talk. Certification, we will talk. So there are like SAFe Leading SAFe program, SAFe Scrum Master program, SAFe Product Owner program, and it may confuse us, are there a different variant or what they are? We will definitely talk towards that at the closing. Any other input for a Scrum Master? Like let's zoom in into this area only. Or any question for a Scrum Master? Now this is an assumption people understand Scrum Master roles, so you just observe. Okay. But any challenge or any question specific to a Scrum Master in SAFe environment?
How it is different from Scrum and SAFe?
Okay. See, simple. What is the role of Scrum Master? Let's explore that. Without SAFe. He facilitates teams to perform well. He provides an environment so the team can work. Okay. Now the same work he has to do in SAFe also, but now this environment is impacted by many other teams because you plan together with other 9 teams, you execute together with other 9 teams. You would be providing something and taking something. Now, you also need a one spokesman who keeps going to other teams and talk about what you guys are doing and what they are doing. That SAFe Scrum Master becomes that guy. So, along with facilitation which he is doing inside his team, he is also doing the stakeholder management and communication with other teams. So that, because he's managing multiple stakeholders now, so that kind of skills need to be added. That's the one thing. So you need to add better communication and facilitation and stakeholder management skills in order to perform well in SAFe environment doing Scrum Master. That's the one thing.
So probably I would add that he may need a lot of more matrices because he is doing stakeholder management, right? So that's where Kanban and other things come into picture, because in normal Scrum you don't talk about Kanban that much.
True. The another thing is, if I build on his point, since there are multiple teams, they might be using different frameworks.
Flow management and all.
Yeah. So in the SAFe environment, not each team is expected to use just Scrum. There could be a possibility that some teams are using Kanban. Now, a SAFe Scrum Master should have an understanding of what they are doing, how they are doing, and how can I get my work done from them. So that kind of understanding and knowledge is something apart. And taking this forward, if somebody goes for SAFe Scrum Master program, especially an advanced Scrum Master program, you end up learning all that. You focus on understanding the patterns and anti-pattern of the teams so that you build on that. You also understand how a Kanban team works in SAFe environment, so you understand how to interact with them. So that kind of knowledge is added on a basic Scrum.
Scrum Master, if I have to add on, is more when you are working in silos. You have a team, you have a team goal, you are actually delivering that team goal to an end customer or something, and that's done, you are done with it. Right? But when you look at SAFe, you look at all interdependence. For example, in a company, there is a product team, there is an implementation team, there is a support and sustenance team, there's an IT or a cloud ops team. Now, each of these people, say IT and cloud ops, work on Kanban, for example. There is a support and sustenance which works on a mixture of both. It's a Scrum Bar, some people call it Scrum Bar. Or there is a product team which could be working on an XP kind of thing. And there is a professional services team which is working on pure play Scrum because they just take it out. Now there is interdependency of all of these. That's where your SAFe will help you connect all these moving parts, help you deliver your project which is not dependent but interdependent. There are a lot of interdependencies, right? It's like our human body. When you are looking at Scrum, you are looking at only a respiratory system. But when you are looking at SAFe, it's the entire body. Right? So how?
Great point.
One question. So it need not be necessary that all the Scrum teams are integrated with each other.
Depends on your organization.
But we the organization. So end of the day, it is, we we know that we are achieving organizational growth. But still, for the Scrum Master, he is also reaching his goal. But it's not necessary that each Scrum teams that's in the lowest level are interrelated to each other.
So if you take his argument forward,
they're supposed to work from a common product backlog, right?
Yeah. So if you take this argument forward and analyze it, what does it mean? One train, which we use the word train, which means a collection of 5 to 12 teams working together. So when they get formed as a one train, first question. One train definition is they plan together, they execute together, they chase the target together. If they are not chasing the target together, then they will not necessarily be a one team. That's the one thing. Now, they have a common target. Now, inside the team, how do you divide the team? Do you divide team feature-wise or do you divide the team component-wise? If you have a feature-wise team, which means they pick up the common backlog from a program, but they have a capability to finish, or one team has a capability to finish complete feature end-to-end without depending on someone else. So if you have a more feature team, the dependency management work will be less. Still you have a coordination, scrum of scrum, because you are planning working together, but you are still relatively less dependency management work. But if you have, say, 20%, 30% or 50% component teams, as the number of percentage of component team will increase, your dependency management work will become more and more complicated. But again, it is depending upon how your product is designed, how your industry is, and this is something which a SAFe program consultant will guide the organization when they are planning their implementation. So like some of you are thinking of going to an implementation, during implementation stage, some of your coaches might have studied how the work is done, how the product is done, and how we should come to a stage where we can form different teams working in a one train. So it depends upon train design.
Maybe we can also just, maybe, you know, I will not answer. Maybe just 1 minute on the train analogy, that why it's a train, because it's a hopper hopper, right? That defines the...
Anyone talk about like this? Again, everybody has a different answer about it. So there's like, yeah.
Might be some question already on the board.
I have a question. So basically, we had a question that like how to overcome, you know, bring back to the agility model to bring as a philosophy kind of thing. And how do we ensure that our organization is ready to go to the same agenda? How to change the mindset?
So maybe
you
write it down. Maybe you write it down and we see. So just can you write it down and then I will paste it. You want to make something?
So I can give you a real world example, and this is from Scaled Agile itself. So we practice what we preach. And back in the days when we were a very small organization, around 30, 40 people, we started adopting SAFe. We wanted to see, because we recommend people to start SAFe when you're 50 plus in the product team that you're working, but we adopted even before that. We wanted to see how that overweighs the benefits. Now, what happened is when you're talking about SAFe implementation, I think the very first step is, and as you can see in the implementation roadmap, and both these pictures that you see opposite to each other, they go hand in hand, right? This is the path, the proven way that you can go ahead and implement SAFe in your environment. And that's the framework which actually brings all the roles together. So one thing is that there are different roles in the organization, and it's a very curriculum, very role-based and role-focused curriculum that SAFe provides, such that each and every role in the organization would have some part to play. It's not that Scrum Master would be different from a product owner, would be different from an RT, would be different from a team which is a very technical team, testers, QAs, all these guys, right? So that's why there's a very focused on effort. Now, if you look at this implementation roadmap, the first one is around getting leadership on board, which is one of the foundation of the Lean, House of Lean, which comes from the Toyota, right? So you have to get the leadership support, you have to get the leadership buy-in as well. The immediate after that is identification of the value stream. Now, what is a value stream? Do you have a good understanding, a common understanding of what a value stream is?
So,
the
Lean method,
not really, maybe.
Okay, you don't have value stream, that's right.
Yeah,
it's not a method. Basically, you are seeing what is your value first, right? And then you are seeing the flow management.
Right.
There are five steps.
More about your future desired state.
Right.
and how do you
exactly your current state, future data state, and
current future, future, how do you reach there, and then how do you cut down your waste?
So think of this, and then I'll just give you a real world example from the Scaled Agile organization as well. So we have different teams, and for simplicity's sake, let's cut down to four teams. We have enterprise consulting team, we have partner management team, we have marketing team, and we have which other team that I can bring on? Enterprise sales team, for example, right? There's consulting, enterprise sales, partner management, and marketing. Now, when we are working all as a one value stream. What is the value stream? It's the lead to cash. Think of that, right? So where your trigger happens of the value, and by the time that you actually deliver the value and get the monetary benefit of it, that's where the end goal is, right? So everything that happens between that, from that lead to cash, is a value stream. So you start thinking from the organization's perspective that what is your product line? What is the trigger which happens? If you look at, let's say, booking, GoIBO kind of an example, right? What is that lead? Lead comes from maybe a Google ad, maybe from a third-party advertisement. So that becomes your start of the value stream, and then you break it down to various systems. So what happens at, during the implementation of it, you start thinking that, okay, so I have to create a courseware and sell the courseware to customers like yourself. So who would be the one who would actually work on that? So the partner management team who's actually working with partners and helping them build a business model around selling the courseware and selling the consulting services. Then there are consultants at Scaled Agile which help the partners run some of those classes, run some of those consulting. And their marketing team which actually also helps the partners and also does direct marketing as well. So all these teams, do you think they have dependency within each other?
Yeah.
Right? They're all connected. So they became a value stream. Everybody has dependency on each other. Now, if I'm doing something, if I have to deliver something to Saket in November, and November is quite too far, let's say next iteration, right? And if my, when I'm planning, if my consultants are not available, and if they don't know that the consultant has to come down and deliver a class with Saket next iteration, how would that be? That's a disaster of a situation, right? So what starts happening is that when you start for, around the value stream, and then you start taking all these roles together and finding out dependencies across different teams. And the role of the Scrum Master is, for all these four teams that we have four different Scrum Masters. These are, think of these like four such teams side by side. All of them would have a Scrum Master who would be responsible for knowing what the team is doing. There would be a product owner who would be working with the product manager and refining the backlog and prioritizing the backlog depending on the business value. And then there would also be an RTE which will help facilitate across the Scrum Master. Now what these Scrum Masters do, the Scrum Master not only work with their team only, because now they have cross-functional dependency, they have to also work in removing the impediments and solving the impediments across different teams. So if the consultant says that, no, I'm not available next iteration, I cannot come down to meet with Saket, then the Scrum Master's responsibility of that consulting team is to what's holding you back. Because this one may be priority, and that priority might have been already decided by the business owner. So this one takes priority over the other one. Can we move that one? Can somebody else take that up, right? So we do a lot of those activities where we mitigate the risks or accept the risk, right? So we will talk about that maybe. So the Scrum Master is not limited to helping the team, but he's also responsible for helping resolve the dependencies and the impediments, removing the impediments across different teams so that all those teams can now deliver the value on cadence. Now they're all working together, they're coming together as a program, as an agile release train, and they are delivering on cadence. There are system demos which are happening every iteration, and we talk about all those things, and there are inspect and adapt which happens. There are retro which happens for each and every iteration, then at the end of the PI we have inspect and adapt which happens at the train level. So all those things. So Scrum Master is not only for the team. The team, of course, he or she is representing the team, but he or she would also be the spokesperson, the voice of that team, in helping resolve the dependencies and remove the impediments from across all these stakeholders, across all the teams that are working together. So now you would see that from the Agile release train, you would have identified a few Agile release trains. There are, let's say, two Agile release arts, as we call them. Each art would have an RTE. RTE would have whatever number of Scrum Masters the number of teams are, and the Scrum Masters would work to help resolve the dependencies and impediments at the team level. They would go to the RT, the Scrum Master. There's so many ceremonies which happen, and the RTs work together to help resolve the dependency across teams, across arts, whenever that is. And you can see that there is a agile release train, and then of course depending on how much you want to scale agility in the organization, we could go to the solution train and do the portfolio level, and that's one. So, but you always start small. You don't start with the entire big picture. You always start with the essential SAFe configuration. That's the one that you start with. So that's one train, and then you go one train by another train.
So you plan top down, but you implement bottom.
That's right. Yes.
Plan top down, implement bottom.
And that's where the business owners come, because when you're doing the PI planning, the business owners would assign the business value to each and every of your objective, and then that will give you that, oh, it's a 10 on 10. It's a revenue that you have to make, 10 mil in this quarter. That's number one priority. Oh, this is just an event, a meetup which is happening in Bangalore. Maybe it's not 10, maybe it's 5 or 6, right? So that's how business owners would help you prioritize. And that also goes to the product management. Then product management looks at the backlog of the team, all the features get, and then features are broken down to stories and so on and so forth. So that's the process that I guess everybody's aware of.
So the product owner is there for all the Scrum teams.
Yes.
And the business owner can be responsible to each product owner to get the product story, user stories from the business owners, from the business case.
The product manager's responsibility is to get the features, and business owners help prioritize. So the product managers are working on the CI/CD cycle. They're always continuously exploring, continuously integrating, and continuously deploying, right? So we are, they're always responsible, they're always getting the features are getting in the backlog, and they're always prioritizing the backlog, whatever is committed for that PI. Sometimes they move certain things because there's something emergency which comes up, they are the one who can actually take that decision whether to move something out of the PI or maybe put lower down the priority in the backlog. And they are the ones who actually work with the product owners for different teams and help them break it down to stories, and those stories are prioritized by the product.
And there is any conflict between these Scrum Masters? RT is responsible for resolving.
So there's a ceremony which is Scrum of Scrums which happens. So if I have, let's say, the same situation, right, that there's a consultant who's not available to come and deliver the class with Saket. So what happens is that I visit with my Scrum Master. Scrum Master goes and talks to the other Scrum Master. And maybe if there's a serious conflict, then RT helps resolve that conflict, right? And then we always refer to what is the business value. The business value is that revenue should be at the top. And maybe there's a conflict in revenue again over there because the consultant might be working on another engagement, and this is a class which is coming up. So, you know, we find a way to help resolve that, or we accept that risk, or we find somebody else to fill in. So there's always a way in this construct to help resolve conflicts and remove the impediments. And that's the primary responsibility of the Scrum Master and the RT.
So how different this RT is from a legacy program delivery manager?
Okay, so we put this question there, yeah, and else we will be remaining this question and reading.
No, that's right.
Yeah. Okay, so I move this thing out now. So Scrum Master role in SAFe, and the certification part is still pending, but the Scrum Master role in SAFe I move.
But can I just ask, does this explanation, I know it's a very short explanation, but I was just trying to bring in the real world implementation as what we do, and you would have your own real world life examples as well, but does this kind of help answer some of us the question and get a better understanding as to what the Scrum Master does in SAFe construct?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so there are many.
You are doing an inspector in
that. Thank you. So now we have a lot of things which are directly and indirectly related to the certification path and learning. So something like, how do I get started in my SAFe journey? What kind of SAFe, various certificate in SAFe? How do we implement SAFe in an organization? How do I become a SAFe trainer? And how do I work with a distributed team in SAFe? It's not certification, it's a particular question. So I think we solve this certification question first, and then we move, because it will help me to take many things out. Career growth or whatever, Scrum, what after Scrum Master certificate, what do I do in order to become a Scrum SAFe trainer? Okay, so these are something which we go. So how do we get started? I think I facilitate and then you get the question. The first thing comes in your mind is, how do I start learning SAFe? Okay, at least that could be the first entry point. Now, you also need to see what is your goal of learning SAFe. Means what role you want to fit into in the Scaled Agile framework. So first recommendation should be that go to an internet and know a little bit about SAFe and various roles in SAFe. And you identify what you want to target. Now, assuming you just want to understand SAFe from an overview perspective and you are into a general management and leadership roles. If you are playing that role, the Scaled Agile has a program called Leading SAFe, which gives you a certificate called SAFe Agilist. The advantage or the target audience for Leading SAFe is leaders. So the way implementation of SAFe starts, it starts with creating awareness about SAFe. So Leading SAFe answers the question, what is SAFe? Okay. So if you want to know the answer of this question, what is SAFe, how these four layer works, how the release happens in SAFe, who does what in SAFe, one should look for a Leading SAFe program, which gives you a certification called SAFe Agilist. Now, another thing is, I'm talking little advanced certificate first, implementing SAFe. Now, if your goal is, I want to be a SAFe implementer, I want to tell organization how to bring SAFe in your company, and I want to be a key contributor towards organization's SAFe transformation journey. If you want to do that, then it requires another certification program, which is called implementing SAFe. Now, what question it answers? It answers, what is SAFe? First, because before you answer how to implement SAFe, you should know what is SAFe. So this certification gives you answer of what is SAFe, and second, how to bring it in an organization. Now, this is relatively a big work. The people who are aspiring to become SAFe program consultant, they need to first know SAFe and have this certification program, but it also requires stakeholder management, overall understanding of how things work, project management understanding, agile understanding, because you end up doing a lot of influencing job. So if you see that you want to do that, or if you are already there, then you may look for a program called Implementing SAFe. Yeah. Implementing SAFe is a little expensive program than others. Reason is, it is not only a training program, it is a program which authorizes you to become a consultant of SAFe, which means once you do that, you are authorized to train others on SAFe. So you can run Leading SAFe program and other programs. Okay? So that's a two program. Now, assuming you think, oh no, I am working as a Scrum Master in SAFe environment. Do they have a program which primarily targeted towards a Scrum Master? So answer is yes. They have two programs. There is one SAFe Scrum Master and there is a SAFe Advanced Scrum Master. So my usual perspective is, if you are just getting into Agile world and you are doing a Scrum Master role and you are new to Scrum process, you may start with SAFe Scrum Master. Now what it answers? It answers, what is the role of SAFe Scrum Master in SAFe? That's the question this certification program will handle. And it empowers you to understand what is SAFe and how the Scrum Master role is worked there. Now when you look at what is SAFe answer in this particular certification program, the answer is limited to Scrum Master role. It doesn't get into the other portfolio or solution role that much, because you need to know your boundary and your contribution in that game. Similarly for product owner and product management. So the Scale Academy have a certification program called SAFe POPM, which is primarily meant for product management and product owner's role. Now, little bit brief, because we spoke about release train engineer and Scrum Master roles. In SAFe, the product discovery, product visioning, and product selling is done by two roles, product management and product owner. Product management is a program level integrated role where this role is providing direction to multiple teams together. So it is like somebody discovering requirement at a cross level, which is good enough to align 10-11 teams. And the product owner is another person who takes this cross requirement and divide it into a refined small requirement, which is good enough to get done in a one iteration. So that's a product owner's role. So if you are playing a product owner product management role, you should look for SAFe POPM. So you can find these programs there. Now there are many other programs as well, but so at this point in time, I focus another one is a SAFe Advanced Scrum Master. So this you can see here, and it also linked with your implementation path. So like SPC is the first thing because you need people who will drive the transformation journey. So this diagram represent implementation roadmap for SAFe. So if somebody organization is taking journey towards SAFe, they follow this path. Okay, so in this path, first the SPC takes them forward. Then you leading SAFe creates an awareness of SAFe into managers and senior stakeholders. And before you launch a train, you need to get product backlog ready, or a program backlog or team backlog, program backlog ready primarily. So that is why in a preparation to launch, we start with POPM first. So the product owner, product manager should get educated, they start working on, looking at the requirement in a way which fits into the framework. Then we look into a Scrum Master and then we look for a team. So there is a certification program for SAFe for teams, which is primarily the team members, the development team members who are working in a team, how they should work in a SAFe environment. That part is covered for SAFe for teams. Now once you are launched, there has been some results, then you go for more advanced programs like Release Train Engineer, Advanced Scrum Masters, and there are more now. There is a program for software engineering.
Agile Software Engineering, SAFe DevOps.
Yeah, there is a program for SAFe DevOps. There is an architect, so there are more programs now. So I think you can explore that. The go-to place is scaledagile.com. You can find all the certification details and you know where to go for.
Though the SPCs are senior level, usually the SPC also play the role of RD.
See, the branding of certificates are different. The idea of SPC is a person who comes, launch, and go.
Okay,
the release.
So SPC will not stay back.
Technically, that's the path. So he might keep coaching. He might keep coaching and keep discovering and launching things. Where the release train engineer is impediment removing job. So if my team is stuck, if my stakeholder is not giving input, if my server is not working and it gets escalated, it needs to be resolved, release train engineer. Whereas program consultant coach will not get into a server issue resolution.
And more on strategy direction, showing the implementation.
And that's the part. Now again, there is a possibility some SPCs playing an RD role.
Just to show how it is done, this is for example, traditional agile transformation. Agile coaches do play the role of a scrum master sometimes.
Sometimes
just to
model, to show how it is
done, how it is done, and then they exit out.
Perfect point. Yeah.
I think one of the other things also is continuous improvement, because you can't expect an art to be just 100% there at just a very kickoff. So it needs to continuously build on the capability of the Agile release train. So the general guidance of Scaled Agile is that for every train, you could have at least 1 to 2 SPCs so that they can be attached to that part, the Agile release train, and then help them continuously improve. At least one SPC should always be there to guide the entire Agile release train, because there will always be, you know, something coming up, and they would always be looking up to somebody who can provide the guidance on how do we approach forward in certain scenarios. So 1 to 2 SPCs to start with, and then maybe on the long term for continuous improvement, one SPC should always be looking at. And then it's not that one-on-one mapping, so that one SPC could be working on multiple arts, but then and he could be part of the Lean Agile Center of Excellence, or what we also call LACE, but there should always be an SPC to go to for an art. If there's a question, if there's something which they're looking for guidance, there should always be an SPC to go to them. They can start launching one art by another art, but then there should be always one SPC who's available for coaching for continuous improvement. There's one of the relentless improvement, that's a fourth pillar of House of Lean as well, so that's where it's driving its principles.
Right. So does this answer your certification queries? Like, so how do I take it forward? What do I do after Scrum Master? So you got some path?
Yeah.
Okay, how do you know various certification? How do you, I'll keep it here. How do I get started on my SAFe journey? And how do I become a SAFe trainer? So I think that is also answer, yeah.
So now, SAFe Agilist is the most popular course, right?
It's most popular for two reasons, the way I see it, right? Number one was that it was one of the earliest courses that we created, along with implementing SAFe. Those were the only two courses which existed back in the days.
SPC and SAFe,
right? And the second thing is that I guess in India, everybody wants to be a leader, right? right? So there's a general tendency of doing leading safe, and most of the people sometimes they think, oh, SPC is very expensive, I can very well do a leading safe and start leading the enterprise to safe, but that's a very wrong understanding. You might know how safe works by doing leading safe, but then you would not be able to implement safe in an organization construct. So they're two different, and that's why the cost difference is what it talks about. What is it that you want to get out of that certification? Not just look at the expense or the ticket price of that certification, but what exactly that you want to achieve. If you want to do certain things, then there's a different certification for that.
SPC,
one question at a time, please.
So it's better that we do implementing safe instead of leading safe, right? Because it covers all the three parts. You can coach, you can actually get an understanding of the safe. Also, you get an
implementation knowledge as well.
And if that's your career path, if that's the interest, and that's enterprise, as Saket mentioned, it requires you to be, you know, pretty experienced convincing the senior leadership, senior exec, selling it to the CXO, selling and driving the implementation in a large organization, being able to manage stakeholders. It takes a lot. Usually SPCs are pretty senior people. Some of us are there in the room as well. So and then leading safe is something that you can, if you're not in that role, if you're not a change agent, if you are just somebody who would facilitate and help and support safe in your organization, then you can pretty much do leading safe or whatever it makes sense for your role, Scrum Master or Advanced Scrum Master, whatever role that you have, you will always find a certification for you with the safe construct in your organization.
See, I think that leading safe, since this is for executive managers and leaders, I think most people are attending the wrong training, because if I see the kind of roles, many of us would have even come for this meetup thinking the role of a Scrum Master or a PA, right? But the training which most of us attend is a leading safe. So it looks like it's only for executives and managers.
That
right?
is right. And yes, I agree with you. And I've seen people who are the QAs, they're doing leading safe. And when I ask them, what do you want to do? And there's this VP who's sitting in the room, and there's a QA sitting in the room. And they're doing leading safe.
Yeah, like, for the VP, it makes sense. It's
exactly.
Executives, right?
Right. So, yeah, most of the people actually end up doing it.
But
wrong.
The other trainings are not so popular, right? Looks like I have not seen that much.
And that's why this meetup is for, to increase the awareness, to ensure that, and we always take baby steps, right? So this is an effort to increase the awareness so that people don't end up doing it wrong, and that would also not.
So if somebody is a CSM or a PSM, can they directly do RTE training instead of?
That's Saket's question.
Yeah, you can.
Okay.
Yeah, RTE and all these things you can do.
Okay.
And
See, in fact, what we have just to take what Pranjal's thing further, right? It's not your certification which will enable you to do it. If you're already a change agent, if you're already an influencer, then you would rather do an SPC.
Right.
You should. It should not be that just because you did a certification, you get that role. No.
Because
you're doing that, you do the certification to get the knowledge.
Yes.
Because for SPC and all, it's more of an experience required rather than just
perfect.
Getting
and
it's
a path. Again, this is an aspiration path. There is nothing. And then you put your milestone. Where, how do you build the thing? And you can definitely build a path for that. Great. Let's move. And how do we implement SAFe in an organization which is new to SAFe? So there is a video which talks about implementation roadmap rather than explaining So if you go to YouTube, just search for implementation roadmap and you will find my video of 20 minutes which explains it. But in summary, it is this chart which starts with first creating a group of change agents. The change agents who can influence others to new way of working, as well as who are authorized to teach SAFe to the group. So you form a center of excellence, lean center of excellence, where there are change agents. And these people go with an educational journey. So the SAFe implementation starts with first educating people on SAFe. And I think Pranjal lightly covered the implementation roadmap as well. And once the education is done, then you start creating a roadmap for implementation. So in a summary way, you can think of, out of 1,000 people in your organization, you may identify 200 who will go first. But first you educate your leaders and you use some logics to identify which are the 200 which will go first. And once those 200 goes on SAFe journey and you observe how the results are coming, you take it to the rest of the people. So So it's an incremental implementation approach. It is not a big bang implementation approach. That is something how it works. But in a simple way, it starts from educating people on SAFe and organizing people in a SAFe construct. Yeah.
Before that also, any due diligence that whether the organization fits.
Yes, that's the important point. Now, recently, in SAFe 4.6, the SAFe has added something called competencies, the five competencies. Now, five competencies, I look for two directions. One is these five competency also helps you how ready are you to take a journey. And it also gives you a roadmap. That framework alone will not solve your problem. You need to have a competency to go forward. See, I can apply Scrum, I can apply SAFe, I can apply Kanban, but if I don't know how to code, what I will do? I can create sprint, but how do I code inside the sprint? I don't know. Yeah. So nothing will work. And I can blame that SAFe is not working or Scrum is not working for me. Simple. Huh? So this competency gives the direction. And it also gives a direction how much ready we are. So there are five competencies, and I see team and technical agility as a first competency and leadership. So you can see here on this picture, lean agile leadership and team and technical agility. In my consulting comments or discussions, when I get this question, I focus on these two competencies. I think these two competencies is kind of entry criteria for you to do anything in SAFe. So do you have a leaders who are in the mindset of let's try, let's learn, let's inspect and adapt, let's look system. If you have it, then you can probably take this journey forward. The second thing is team and technical agility. Can your team code and finish the sprint work during the sprint boundaries? Now, if your current sprints always spill over, then better you fix that problem first before you get. So you don't scale your problem. You scale your success. So you need to achieve this competency. So I use this competency framework as a readiness framework.
You mean to say that all the Scrum team needs to be matured enough so that they can enter it?
Yeah, so there has to be technical competency. So they know what to commit, how to estimate, how to code, how to integrate. If that is lacking, I'm not saying that stops them doing it, but that would be an area of concern.
Right.
They need to fix that.
You're multiplying the problem.
You have experimented all over the place.
So you need to fix that. So this is something you have to fix. Better you fix it soon. Yeah?
Yes.
Along with your implementation roadmap, you also have a competency building roadmap. And once this is filled, then you talk about DevOps and release on demand capacity. So do you have a competency which can facilitate on-demand releases? So you have integration beyond integration, deployment and releases. So you go there, and then you go there further. So I take it this path of judging where you are, and this is like my customized interpretation of it.
No, that's
fine. So you
can. Two things. One is this thing, and apart from technical and team agility, business agility.
Yeah. So
if the business is really able to,
so that's a lean agile leadership. So in a SAFe terminology, this comes to a lean agile leadership. Do we have a leaders with an open mind? Okay. Then do we have a team who can do the things? So top and bottom's taken care. Then we talk about okay, let's move forward. That keeps that.
Second, what are the remaining prototypes?
So it's a DevOps and release on demand.
Okay.
And then you talk about large solutions. So you can create a large solutions. So you can integrate multiple teams, and then you talk about lean portfolio management. So can you really think of allocating money on a business lines rather than focusing on projects? Do you have that maturity of doing lean business cases that comes?
Yeah, the CFO is agile also.
Yes, that comes little later. So this is like the path.
Is there any company which is already being safe?
ING is a
so you have so many on your table? Yeah, on your table?
45, 50, quite a few of them. Even in Bangalore, quite a few of them. Boeing, there's Philips, there's Intel, there's the joint here, the quite a few. And for the SBCs, just to come back to how to sell, say for the SBCs in the room, you would have access to the executive workshop in the toolkit, right? On the community portal. So there's a 2-minute elevator pitch video of Dean Leffingwell in there. And he talks about how do you actually pitch SAFe to the organization. So that's where he teaches about how do you pitch to the leaders. You always get leaders trained first. If the leaders are not willing to commit and change themselves, there is no way that you can carry lean agile leadership. And you have to do that. That's a foundation. And that's the foundation which SAFe House of Lean talks about as well. So you have to get the leadership buy-in, and that's how you actually progress, as Saket mentioned.
Yeah.
But yeah, getting leadership on board is the most critical aspect.
Yes. I mean, if they're seeing success of Agile and Scrum working for them, eventually our leadership will buy in.
So
for
I
them,
think most of the
conversations
are
other way around.
You have to believe before you can see.
Yeah.
You can't see and believe. That's for any innovation.
Great, but again, this is like, it's again subjective and context sensitive for discussion.
Right.
This is something which we can focus on. Great. Now, Pranjal, question for you. Do we need to pay any royalty charges for implementing SAFe?
No.
Yeah, but there is, if you are SPC, there is a capex and OPEX, right, that you have a yearly.
There's just a training fee, right?
Something not training fee. No, you have to
so renewal
SPC, you need to pay.
Yes, of course.
Renewal fees.
Yeah.
Why do we charge that? Why do we charge that? Can you answer that question?
Royalties.
Yeah. No, it's not a royalty.
It's more of a certification
okay.
And toolkit, I guess.
No, I think the question
so,
is different. For implementing SAFe,
no. I think, yes, it's right that you're calling out. There's two aspects of it, right? One is, for implementing SAFe, do we need to provide any royalty? No.
That was my question.
And there
you
are two questions.
For that.
Right. Yeah, sorry.
But there are licenses you can buy.
No, I didn't want to mix between that cost for
let
training.
Let me break it down.
Cost right. For training people is considered.
Yeah. Right.
But if you want to implement that framework, if SAFe or Scale Agile comes to know that, okay, Silpro is implementing
nope.
SAFe, but they are not paying anything to us.
Let me break it down for you.
What I would think is, because, see, I am an SPC, and if I have to renew it, why would I renew it? Because I care for my organization, and I wanted to be there to implement SAFe in the organization. And if I have to continue doing that as an SPC, and if I'm motivated to, you know, renew it, I mean, that is one of the factors, right?
I
simply can't go
so
and renew it, and the organization is not funding.
So let's hear the complete
sure.
Answer, and then we can
yeah.
Probably
so coming to the first question, that yes, for every certification that you do, you have to renew. It's not only SPC. SPC is slightly more expensive than the others. But for every certification that you do, it has a lifetime of 1 year. For every year that you have to renew your certification,
but
as long
for Agile coach, right?
For everybody.
Agile coach is for lifetime.
CC.
I don't know what you are
saying.
Different body, different certificate. I am not authorized to speak on any other framework behalf. I'm only talking SAFe right now. So for all the SAFe certifications, the certifications are valid for 1 year. And you have to renew them as long as there is no major update to the version of the framework. Right now we are under 4.6. There would be a next version out. If that version is 5.0, then some of us would be required to go back to the class and do the class again, because it's a major update. The last one was 4.0, then came 4.5, and then came 4.6, because these are minor updates. So all you have to do is keep on renewing your certification without going to the class. If the next one is 4.7, then you can do pretty much the same. But if it is 5.0, that's a major update, then you would be required, most likely, to go back to the class and take the class again.
So when we renew, by the time if there is a new version, do we get those slides also? Like in Scaled Agile login,
you
get those slides.
Always get release notes as to what is the new in this version.
But we don't get the updated.
You don't get what?
No, if you do the SAFe, you have access to the portal, and then all the content is there.
Yes,
the
and you get even video content to upgrade you. Which
no, the PPT slides, for example, SAFe is released when I attended, it was 4.5. Those PPTs are accessible in my login, right?
Right.
But now, next year when I renew, it will be 4.6 available. Will I be able to download the 4.6 content?
Of course. So not only that, but you will also be required to do an enablement exam for the courses that you will do. For example, you're leading SAFe. So you will be required to do some reading on 4.6. If you're an SPC, and if you're going to teach a leading SAFe, if you're an SPC on 4.5, but you're going to teach a leading SAFe on 4.6, then you would be required to take the enablement exam again, so that you're updated on 4.6.
So for renewing also exam is
there? Sorry?
For renewing also exam is there every year?
No.
Depends.
No, it depends.
Who are you and what kind of
exactly right? So it depends on what your role is and what the version is.
Okay.
If it is, as I said, that if it's a major a version upgrade,
yeah.
Then it's going to be back to the class,
okay.
Taking the exam again, and so on and so forth. Because there's a lot of changes which happen.
Okay.
Now let's stick with the simpler aspect of it. What we asked, that why is it that we have to renew and we have to pay a license fee every year to Scale Agile? It's a continuous learning journey. And it's not only the certification that you get. And that's somebody, if you ask anybody in the room, I don't know how many of us are aware, there's so many resources which are available to us on community portal. And if you go out in the market, there's a very low degree of awareness around the resources which are available to you as a SAFe practitioner, whatever that your certification is, around the resources which are available to you to help you do your job better on a day-to-day basis. And why is that? Because either we unsubscribe from the notifications coming from Scaled Agile, or we just move them to spam and we never care to go back to those emails, right? So if you are continuously looking at those emails and subscribe to all the emails which are coming out from Scaled Agile, you would see that there's continuous notification and news going out that these are the new resources that you can take, new certifications that you can take, how is it that it will help your organization solve a particular challenge, and so on and so forth. So if you are SAFe certified, you go to community portal, there are two or three things which are really, really important, and that's what contributes to the ongoing license fee. One is access to all the toolkits which are available to you. On these toolkits, I don't think, and I can't speak on behalf of any of the frameworks, but what I've heard is that it's so exhaustive, no other framework actually provides those many toolkits, the kind of guidance we provide. If you're running an executive workshop, you don't have to create your slides. If you're running an SOS meeting, you don't have to create your slides. All the templates, all the slides are already there. There are almost like, I guess, 15 plus toolkits which are available to you to help you facilitate all your ceremonies, all the things that you can possibly do in your day-to-day life. There are toolkits available to help you facilitate your interactions better. So that's a continuous practice. And it's for others as well, for SAs, for Scrum Masters, and they would be a limited set, right? So depending on your role, you would have a limited set. SBCs would have everything under the sun that SAFe provides, right? But then for your role, if you're a Scrum Master, if you're an SAFe Agilist, you would have a limited set of it, so that you don't get confused by the others, right? So that's one aspect of it. The second is that you get access to a community of practice. And what is that? It's a community of practice. All the SAFe Agilists in the world, I think 48,000, or I don't know how many people are there. I know for sure there are 11,800 something SBCs around the world. And everybody can go over there, ask questions. And if you go to that particular community of practice, you will see so many questions being asked. People are always helping, contributing, asking questions. You can ask questions if you are facing any specific challenges. There would always be somebody who would be there to help you out. And answer your questions and get you out of the situation. Let's say you're stuck as an SBC, you're working on an engagement and you have a question as to, okay, how do I do WSJF in certain environment? There would be somebody who would have experienced that around the world and they would be willing to help you out. There's so much of interaction. It's a platform that brings everybody together. SBC has access to SBC platform, but if you're a SAFe Agilist, Scrum Masters, all the community of practice would be available to you for your certification so that you can talk to your like-minded people around the world. So that's a continuous value. The third value is there are a lot of resources around how to sell SAFe, how to contribute to SAFe, how to bring SAFe to the enterprises. There are different presentations which are done around the world. Most of them are from the methodologists Inbar, Oren, and Dean Leffingwell. There's so many presentations which happen around the SAFe summits, and those are really, really valuable. The content, the collaterals are already available over there that you can download, use it, reference to it, learn from it, and the resources are not exhaustive. They're continually evolving, right? That's the third thing, a great learning opportunity. The fourth thing is access to the member directory. So if you are looking for certain roles in certain cities, in certain regions, if you want to find out, hey, who are the leading SAFe people who in Bangalore, and I want to maybe interact with them, or who are the SBCs in Kuala Lumpur, I want to interact with them. So you can always find the people, and maybe if they have updated their contact details, you can always connect with them. So that also gives you that opportunity to network with like-minded people and start contributing, or maybe run meetups, maybe find a consulting gig together, maybe support a customer in a different region, and so that you are able to work with them and collaborate with them, find partnering opportunities. So the options are limitless, right? So these are the resources which are available to you as a general practitioner. Of course, there are more resources which are available to the partners, like Eisenbridge. There's a separate partner portal, and there are too many resources over there as well, which Saket and his organization can always help you out with. But then as a general practitioner, as a SAFe certified, whatever certification that you take, these are the things that are available to you on a continuous basis, and that's what you pay for every year. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
So no royalty, but the certification.
It expires every year. You have to pay every year. And it's for all the two-day courses that you have, it's just $100. SPCs, it's
$895. Can you renew it later on? Let's say I didn't renew it for 6 months or a year.
I think yes. You can give a gap of 2 years and then.
If you are on the same version, so let's say if you renewed in 3.0, you took 3.0 for example, and the 4.0 came off. You did 4.0, 4.5, 4.6, and 5.0 came. So you have to go back to the class and do that.
Yeah, I would prefer to use a safe license. Right? How that for that enterprise who are implementing safes, they may have like 4 or 5 licenses, but they have 100 teams. How that works out?
Do you want to elaborate on that? What do you mean by safe license?
Some there may be a big organization.
What do you mean by license? Like specific courseware license?
No, so there is nothing like a safe license.
So there is nothing as such.
No.
So it's more like they might have a 4 SPCs.
Oh, like that. Okay. So maybe the wording is.
Yeah. So as an SPC is progressing through and implementing SAFe within an organization, as a result of that, you end up training other roles, right?
Oh.
The product owners, product managers, scrum masters. And for everybody who gets hand on the courseware, you have to, as an SPC, you have to purchase a license. In some of the scenarios, I even heard from people that, oh, there are senior VPs in the room, they're just going to be over there, and they're not going to take the certification. Can I just hand over the courseware to them and not purchase a license for them? The answer is no. Whoever gets their hand on the courseware, they are supposed to, the SPC is supposed to get as many number of licenses as the attendees in the class. They take the certification as attendee or not, that's their decision, but they have to, the SPC has to get that number of licenses.
So just tie it to that, tie those.
So it's a courseware license that you purchase.
Related question. Let's say I bought a license and the person didn't do the whole training. So what will happen to that?
So sorry, say that again.
So SAFe is 2 days training and you need both of these attendance. If they don't do the second day, what will happen to that license?
So you get them out of the roster. There's a roster which has to be uploaded, and have they? Maybe they paid the fee, right? If they have not attended both the days, they are not eligible to take the certification. You refund them back and ask them to come back later.
Okay.
And you don't put their names on the roster. The way
they
licenses,
get the courseware,
huh?
But they will get the courseware.
They got the courseware. You get and take that back.
Okay.
Yeah. They're not. You're not allowed to give them the courseware because you did not purchase a license from them. And the way the licenses are consumed is that when, as an SPC, you've done the class, there are 20 attendees in the class, you put 20 names on the roster, you purchase 20 licenses, so that will be accounted for. If one dropped off, you will get 19 licenses consumed, one would remain on your account, which you can use later.
So,
Pranjal,
that license is required only if you want a certificate for them. Otherwise, if SPC is there and you can just conduct it and you can attend in that way.
So, how do you deliver a training? You deliver a training specific to a particular course. You deliver a training for Scrum Masters, you deliver training for product owners, product managers, so there's a classes. You cannot have a like a group training. If it is a group training for the entire art, it could be either SAFe for teams or SAFe DevOps. There's no other training that you can do for the entire Azure release training, like 100 people, right? And if the SPC would be training specific roles, like Scrum Master training,
yes.
15 people, 20 people, whatever, right?
Okay.
Product owner, product managers, 25 people. There's a SAFe, another training that could pick you up, that you can pick up. So those are very role-specific trainings which are done for that particular role itself for 2 days, right? And whatever number of people are there in the class, you have to purchase the licenses so that you can download the courseware, get it printed, hand it out to them, and they, so the course fee, that the license that you're paying for is for both the courseware and the certification. It's not that you can give them out the courseware and they don't take the certification. The license is for both the courseware and the certification. If you haven't bought a license for them, then they don't get their hands on the courseware. That's illegal, right? So they can pay for their fee, the license fee. They can take the course and they can choose to not take the certification. That's their decision. But as a trainer, you have to buy that number of licenses for number of people in the class. And if you're printing X number of 20 attendees 20 coursewares, you have to purchase 20 licenses.
Suppose you don't bring, just
you have to.
So I think the idea here is any SPC delivering class has to buy the courseware license. That's it.
Okay.
Now, even if the SPC creates his own courseware, his own concept, still technically it is not allowed because his program would be competing with some of the existing Scaled Agile programs.
Okay.
So if you have created a program, but Scaled Agile already had created a leading SAFe program for that requirement. So you are not expected to create your program.
No, I am not talking about that. I think that leading SAFe, I heard that SPCs can conduct the leading SAFe. That's what my understanding was. So now, if they want to conduct the leading SAFe to the executives, right?
Still,
he will not give printout and all.
Whatever.
But he will already have that slides in his login, right?
Yes.
So can he run through that presentation to a...
Workshop for that. So there's an executive workshop which lasts for 2 hours. So if you go in a meeting, let's say in 10, and you want to talk to their senior directors, senior VPs, and sell them the idea of SAFe,
okay,
there's an executive workshop toolkit which is available to you, which you can go and walk them through the slides,
yeah,
and convince them to get to the two-day leading SAFe class.
Okay.
But when you're doing the class, it's a two-day class,
okay,
you have to print the courseware, you have to run it the same way which is expected of all the SPCs.
Okay.
If you don't end up doing that, then...
Okay.
To answer your question, if you just see the PPT, you can misinterpret, right?
Yeah.
So you need to be in a class to interpret properly.
So organization, they hire a consultant to implement SAFe, and he's typically a consultant in the company. So he can give coaching to an entire team, right? An organization.
So see, again, there are, what is it legal or is it
can be done.
So I guess coaching can be done, but any training delivery, the SPC is expected to go through a SAFe curriculum and delivery. That's
the including the organization.
Even there is a rule, the PowerPoint is black and white, you cannot put colors.
Yeah. No, even with the whatever you have.
Okay, so I think let's move. You have a final point, something? Or no?
It was the same thing. Can we give the black and white PowerPoint for it?
No.
Or leading SAFe to somebody who did not attend leading SAFe? No.
Once they
attended, they can give the only credentials.
Soft copy can be passed on.
No, they
will download their own. Once you have that login,
their only PDF format. Not PowerPoint.
Let's say I'm the trainer, you're doing the leading SAFe. So I provided the courseware to you as a hard copy, you did that both the 2 days in the class. When you finish the class, I'll be putting your name in the roster. The roster goes back to Scaled Agile. They will activate your own login to the community portal. In your login, you will be able to download all the slides in black and white, what you will receive as the hard copy. But you're not authorized to resell it or share it with anybody else. You are governed by a courseware license agreement.
Okay, so now what I do? Quick answers to all of these questions.
One more question.
Yeah.
If somebody having multiple certificates, he has to renew all of them?
Yes. And pay $100 separately.
SPC, if you have SPC, everything else.
Yeah, SPC is the exception. If you have SPC, rest of the things are
taken.
And advanced Scrum Master is also a little exception. If you are doing Scrum Master and advanced Scrum Master, then if you renew advanced Scrum Master, your Scrum Master also get it. So there are two exceptions here, but both of them has a higher price. I think advanced Scrum Master renewal is $250. So if you pay $250, the Scrum Master certificate also get renewed.
And what are the trainings IGNB is conducting currently apart from leading SAFe?
So we are focusing on advanced Scrum Master EOBM along with leading SAFe. Okay, so quick answers, not the detailed one. And post session, if somebody wants to get into, we can find out how we get into the details. So a case study of real success and all. So you have something on your desk, and you can go to a website called scaledagile.com/case-studies. And there you can find a good amount of details. Yeah, this orange thing. So there are a few case studies, and these are different. You know, these are different. So you can browse, and whoever find it interesting can take it, finally. But you can find more details at scaledagile.com/case-studies. And there are many Indian case studies also. It's not like that all are coming from outside India. So I'm just putting it that here. What matrices should be used for our team health, program health, and all? So as Pranjal said, the Scaled Agile framework is very exhaustive framework. And that is that, in my personal opinion, that is the reason it is becoming popular. Because it's easy to understand and get started with. Definitely you inspect and adapt as you go forward, but it gives you a ready-made place to get started with. So if you go to a scaledagileframework.com, the big picture you have in your front, there's a corner, there's a space called metrics. If you click on metrics, there's a corner space. So here you find a metrics. So if you go to a scaledagileframework.com/metrics, you click the metrics, you will find team level, program level, large solution level, portfolio level metrics. There are extensive number of options. You can use burn down chart at a team level. There are various health radars, and it gives you a proper ready-made assessment system. So I talk to many coaches in general agile industry. Many organizations are still evolving in creating their assessment system, who are not using SAFe. But at a scale agile, you get it ready-made. And it's freely available, now you can also see. And even if you are not using SAFe, I end up recommending many of the clients that you can get an idea of a lot of metrics by just building a scale agile framework. So use that space.
Is it enough in your practice?
It's enough. And see, basic metrics which is focused is PI predictability. So in general, if you see a content as well, so PI predictability measurement is the metrics which is the most focused one, and rest are good for diagnosis.
You can see it.
So in terms of documentation, really,
okay. And role of an engineering manager in SAFe. So there is a role called system architects in SAFe. In agile world, we started with an assumption that self-organizing team can take care of their design and development and architecture. But when you work in a big scale, you need somebody to facilitate design, development and engineering decisions. So Scaled Agile has a role called architect. So sometimes engineering managers get mapped to architect. Other than that, we also have a role called business owners. Sometimes engineering managers just becomes a business owners who are key stakeholders and who would be mentoring their teams, their processes, and they remain involved. So on the train, if you are sitting on the train, the active role is system architect, else you become a business owner. So you need to see the context. Now when you do a SAFe implementation, the implementation team will do a role mapping. That's a very critical exercise. It's just not like one answer cannot be given, but yeah, that's a starting point. And your implementation will bring the strength. Okay, now there are two questions about shared services and distributed team. So shared services can work as a shared services in SAFe. Yeah, so they may provide services to rest of the groups. Now, do you need to bring a production support in the train or outside the train? I have seen both the patterns. If you have a continuous development happening of the same application, then you may want to create a shared responsibility culture, which is the DevOps culture, where you say maintaining as well as developing is a part of us. Then you may do that. But if you have, say, slowing down development, a marginal development is happening and majorly support happening, then there is a possibility that those teams may remain out of train. So it is a little contextual discussion, and it depends upon how much maturity the organization has achieved in SAFe. Even if they want to come into SAFe, that would be later stage. You don't start your SAFe journey by putting production team into SAFe. They won't be the first team. If you have already been through 5-7 teams, then you may see how it is working. So that's the usual thing. How
but
does it work?
We have done both.
Okay, great. Share it.
For a particular group of projects, the production support is part of the train. For a particular group of projects, they're outside.
And it's maturity stage. You know, it don't think of too much in the beginning. It's a part of the journey. Now, how does it work with a distributed team in SAFe? So, the recommendation, again, the implementation pattern may emerge. You are ending on a train, assuming you have 10 teams. These 10 teams, in most probability, would be sitting at a different locations. So they are, because value at such a large extent is difficult to get delivered from one location. So you will have a distributed team. But one team itself, the 9 people team, one team itself working from 2 geography is not recommended. Okay? So you can have different teams working from different locations, having their own team backlog, having their own PI objectives, and they are interacting with other teams through Scrum of Scrum. That is a usual SAFe implementation. But out of 8-9 people itself, one team working from two geography, it can bring more complexity, because scaling already has many complexity related to managing other teams. But if you bring that, it can create confusion. So as a process, as a framework, it is not recommended that you keep small team cohesively at a one location, but multiple teams are expected to work from different. Product owners and product management can flow here and there. But it's this. Okay. So, anything closing you wanna?
No, I think it's pretty much the same. Like, as you mentioned, that there of course have to be distributed teams. And in my context, we are the international partner management team, and two of them are sitting in Germany, and there's one in Tokyo, there's one in Beijing, Chengdu rather, and I'm in Bangalore. So, but we still get together. We have ceremonies which helps us get together. So now you rely on the technology. You work you get together for daily stand-ups at a time which works across time zones. You have access to Jira, and now going forward, given that we have acquired a company called Conteneo, you might know maybe. And there's a Weave platform, so which actually helps us do everything that you can see over here on just one platform. So everybody would have visibility. So it's also that you're doing the framework, but there's a technology which is actually helping facilitate the interactions. So you, of course, will be distributed, but then you have to then figure out a way that you can still able to facilitate the ceremonies and be able to contribute value to every team member, right? So,
how does that mean?
Contenio. It's new comments company.
Jira already has what the templates for the Scrum and the Kanban and all these things.
Sorry,
Jira already has the templates for Scrum, Kanban,
yeah,
and Scrum. Scale. Do they have
Scale? No, we don't provide a tool, and we might as well become a software company now with the acquisition of Contenio, given that we have a Weave platform now under our umbrella. So let's see how that goes, but for the time being, we don't provide any tools. The partners which actually provide tools like Atlassian or Ragtag.
Jira has it. Atlassian is Jira.
Agile Cockpit also has it.
Yes, Agile Cockpit also has.
Quick question about the geographically distributed team. Let's say we want to do our training. Can that be done?
No, remotely no training is. We cannot do any remote training. That is, again, against the personal license agreement. Everybody has to be together when you're doing the training. There's no remote training.
Recommended or is it against the license?
It is not recommended, and it actually flaunts the personal license agreement. There's a section over there.
You can't do it.
You can't do it. The answer is that. You cannot do it. You should not do it.
I have been asking this question for the last 5 years. You can't do it.
Absolutely. So. Have to be together. And there are companies who showed us their state-of-the-art facilities. They have been doing all these different trainings, and I went into this large organization. They have very classroom-like structure. There are people who are sitting in different, and it's not a round table arrangement. The class of all the same courses is a round table arrangement. You get together, you plan together, you do the PI simulation together. How do you do PI simulation if you are in remote locations? You can't possibly work in remote locations and do a PI simulation together, right? So these are various things which you cannot possibly do.
So even if you can do it, as of now, it's not allowed. So even if you have a tools, you have a...
Yeah, long story short, answer is no.
Trello or whatever it is, you create a program code and all, but you can use LinkedIn.
But after that, once you are done, I can understand that some of the people can do participate, and I have had experience participating in the PI planning remotely as well as doing it on campus in the facility, and I would say we were doing the PI planning in Boulder, and there was a state of the art. There was a robot which I was able to drive and go to all the program boards, and there was Scrum Master was actually helping me out. But I think that was the worst PI that I ever had in my life. This is not possible to contribute to the team and understand every team, and I have dependencies on marketing. And how do I drive my robot from here to the marketing team? There are a lot of technical challenges in there.
But if you think about the implementation there, we have talked about two time zones and how to do PI planning with two time zones.
Yes, and that's a quick art launch where you have the Wednesday, Thursday, maybe spill over on the Friday, you can still manage to do it, but it's possible because you cannot fly down everybody from different locations, but that's not the most recommended approach.
But I think the training, no option.
The training is no. But if you can do the PI planning remotely, and I was just sharing my experience, it was the worst of the PIs. I missed out a lot. And I get to go to our headquarters only once in a quarter, so.
So in many organizations, people do fly for PI planning.
Yes, that is a recommended approach.
In Walmart, it is pretty common. People fly from different locations. 125, 150 people in the
auditorium.
Yes.
Even open text,
they also do that.
Good.
Should we
close?
One quick question.
Yeah,
about that acquisition that you made. So what are they into? What is it called?
It's a platform called Weave, W-E-A-V-E.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually helps you do all the stuff that you see over here. So if you are creating a backlog, how do you do WSJF, if you are doing prioritizing on the PI objectives, or if you have a Kanban group backlog, you want to do a retro, you want to do inspector adapt, so everything would be there, and everybody in the train or the entire portfolio would have the visibility to that. So just look up Continuo, Scaled Agile. There's a PR which was done, I guess, last week. If you know Luke Homan, it was his organization, and now Luke is part of, he's an employee of Scaled Agile. It still continues to be an independent brand, but maybe sometime down the line we might merge. So.
Good. So, thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for insightful participation. And for all follow-up query related to certification and all, so Ishan, Kokom, you can reach them. You can visit scaledagile.com, scaledagileframework.com, and for the training tool, you can definitely visit ivanbuild.com. So I'm Saket, and I was like hosting you without introducing myself. So thank you.
You need to.
Of course.